Welcome everyone to this expert interview in our Netzsch Interviews AM Expert Series. I'm Natalie Rudolph and I'm the Business Field Manager Polymer at Netzsch Analyzing and Testing. As part of our video series Material Science and Additive Manufacturing, we received quite a lot of questions surrounding polymer and metal powder bed fusion, what the differences are, and some very specific questions that we wanted to ask one of the experts in the field. And so I'm very happy that I was able to win Professor Wudy from the Technical University in Munich to answer some of these questions. Professor Wudy got her PhD at the Institute of Polymer Technology at the University of Erlangen-Nürnberg, where she worked on polymer powder bed fusion processes. She was at the same time the team lead of the whole additive manufacturing group. And towards the end of her tenure there, she started to also take over the responsibility of CEO of one very big research group that focused on that area. It's an SFB, that's a German research grant, SFB 814, for those of you more familiar and are interested in that. And then 2 years ago, she was offered a position as professor at the Technical University in Munich, and there she has a professorship of laser-based additive manufacturing. Katrin, I'm super happy and excited that you're here, and I'm sure you can help with some of the problems and questions that our audience had. I think I introduced you a little bit what your background is, but I think it would be very, very interesting for the audience to hear what you're doing now. As I said, you're one of the only experts in the world who actually work both on polymer and metal powder bed fusion processes.
Yeah, thank you very much, Natalie, for the invitation, and hopefully I can answer some of the questions of your audience today. So, as you mentioned, I was appointed as professor of laser-based additive manufacturing at the Technical University of Munich at the end of 2019, and my research group is mainly focusing on beam and powder-based additive manufacturing techniques, which means powder bed fusion of plastics and powder bed fusion of metals. And we are dealing with the whole process chain, starting from the powder and the generation of the powder, going through the processes to improve and optimize the processes with different laser sources, for example, and going through design of specific, for example, topology optimized parts. So we cover the whole process chain, and the specific thing is we are dealing with both metals and plastics in the field of powder bed fusion.
So I'm sure you can answer all of those questions, especially much better than I could, but you can add some insights as a real user and power user of those technologies. So I would like to start with one of the more basic concepts. Some of the viewers, or quite a number of the viewers, were still wondering about the differences and also common features of metal and polymer powder bed fusion. Could you talk about that?
Of course, I can talk about this. So first, start with the powder. So the powder here, you can see on this slide, two different kinds of powder. On the left-hand side, it's stainless steel, typical 316L material, so a metal powder for powder bed fusion of metals, with this typical spherical shape of the powder particles. There's some other irregular shape, but mainly typical spherical shape with the particle size, the mean particle size around 40 microns. On the other, on the right-hand side, you see a plastic powder, a commercial one. It's polyamide 12. Polyamide 12 has approximately 90% of the market share, and you can see in this case, these typical potato-shaped powders, and the particle size is around 50 microns. So the particle size is, for both types of powders, almost the same, and also the shape is quite the same. So the powder is in the shape and size almost the same. If we had a deeper look into the processes, we can see quite a huge difference. So on this slide, you see firstly an additive manufacturing process, or rather a powder bed fusion process of metals using a laser beam. And on the picture on the right-hand side, it's quite obvious that there's a strong laser material interaction, which is already visible. And you see these sparkling lights, and in these here, the material interacts with the laser, and this interaction zone could be drafted geometrically, like on the left-hand side. We've got this melt pool and a lot of things going on between the powder particles and the melt pool. They are drawn away from the powder bed and melted. And the specific thing is that after each track of this laser beam, the material is solidified. So it's really a welding process. You weld a specific line of material, and it's quite important that the welding depth is higher than your layer thickness. You can see this on this slide. This was the before melted material, and it's important that the welding depth is higher than the layer thickness. If we have a look on the powder bed fusion process of plastics, it looks a little bit different. First of all, the interaction between the laser beam and the material is not really visible. You only can see, okay, the material is molten. Here you have the solid powder material, and here these a little bit darker sides is the molten material, the molten plastic material. And what is also quite specific is that the before melted layer stays in the molten state like ice cubes in water, and you have this solid material at the same time. So the whole component stays in the viscous state during powder bed fusion of plastics over the whole or almost the whole building process. That's the main difference. And furthermore, of course, you use different types of lasers due to different absorption behavior of these material classes. And the exposure level, so the laser power and the scan speed, is of course also different.
Do we also work at different temperature scenarios? So you said the metal is solidifying, the polymer isn't. How is that possible?
Yes, we work at different temperature levels. And this is something which is specific for the polymer side. So powder bed fusion of polymers can be quite well described with the so-called model of quasi-isothermal laser sintering. On this slide, you see a schematic diocese diagram of a semicrystalline thermoplastic. For example, polyamide 12 would be a semicrystalline thermoplastic. And here you have the melting of the material, and there's a temperature gap between this melting and this crystallization of the material. So on the x-axis, there's the temperature, and here the material melts. And at a lower temperature level, this crystallization starts. And after this crystallization curve, all of the material is crystallized. And the specific or the idea behind is now that you preheat the whole building space, so the whole powder, to a preheating temperature which is near the melting of the material. And with the laser energy input, you increase the temperature to a higher temperature level, but the temperature should not reach, for example, the degradation temperature of the material. And directly after the laser exposure, the temperature is decreased, of course. But it's at a temperature above the crystallization point and the crystallization temperature, which means do you have, as I explained it before, at the same time, the molten material and the solid powder bed like ice cubes in water. So it's a two-phase mixture area.
Okay, so that sparked another question for me about characterization methods, but I'll keep that for a little later if we have time. I would like to continue asking you some of the more specific questions that the audience had now that you talked about the general concepts. And one of the questions I have is really practical. What are the differences in handling metal and polymer powder and maybe also in handling or operating the specific machines?
Okay, the handling in the powder is, in this case, we've seen the powder particles with a scanning electron image before. So the particle size is really small. It's around 40, 50 microns, which is the thickness of your hair, so it's a really thin powder, and therefore you should be careful in handling the powder due to any safety issues. So you have to avoid that the powder goes into your lungs. That's why you have to wear specific safety, security masks, and so on. Unfortunately, in the field of metals, this is quite well developed, this huge field. In the field of plastics at the moment, the people understand that it's also not that good to have plastic powders surrounding you. That's why in this field also the people at the moment are more learning about powder safety measures.
And in the field of metal powders once in a while. So I guess that's part of the reason for the question.
Yeah, and the other topic is that nickel-based powders, of course, are quite harmful. This is, we are well known in the field of plastics. The materials typically are not that harmful, but due to the small particle size, these safety issues are increasing of interest, which is really good. So in our lab, for example, everyone has to wear these whole face masks and some suits, and only with this safety measures they are allowed to go into the lab.
Okay, and the operation of the machine is another question that I tag onto the question of the viewer is, are there manufacturers that produce both machines for polymer and for metal powder bed fusion, or is that really separated?
Yeah, there are manufacturers who produce both, so metal powder bed fusion systems and plastic powder bed fusion systems, because a lot of the system components are quite the same. If we have a look at these optical unit, for example, you need a laser system, you need some mirrors, you need some guidance for the laser beam, you need a building space, which is a mechanical built space. The difference is the preheating for the polymer powders, and the process parameters, of course, are the same, and the guidance of the laser beam is also different because you need different lenses, but there are manufacturers who build both metal and plastic systems, and there are also component suppliers who have parallelly metal manufacturing department and a plastic AM manufacturing department.
Okay, active in both. Yeah, and since you showed the SEMs of metal and the polymer powder, I have another question that's about the powder. And I would actually say the polymer looked a lot more potato shaped. But the question is, were those powders around produced for other processes? And then as someone thought of the idea of powder bed fusion, they repurposed existing powders, or are there really powders that are specifically developed and produced for additive manufacturing, in that case powder bed fusion?
So the requirements posed to the powders are really high in the field of powder bed fusion of plastic and metals. They have to have a specific size, a specific shape, specific rheological, thermal, and optical behavior, and therefore these powders are only or mainly produced for powder bed fusion techniques. Other powders, for example, coming from coating techniques for rotational molding, can not be used for additive manufacturing due to, for example, different particle size distributions.
Okay. And the particle size distribution, they have different requirements because of the way it's applied, or what is the reason you need a certain particle size distribution for powder bed fusion?
Yeah, for powder bed fusion, we've seen that the powder particles are quite small in the field of 50 microns. And this is why the layer thickness in the field of plastics is around 100 microns, which means the powders cannot be larger than 100 microns. They should be smaller than 100 microns. The challenge is if the powder particles are too small, the van der Waals forces between the powder particles increases, and then you got an agglomeration of your powder particles, which, for example, could be seen in some other types of powders.
Is that also the reason why these powders seem to be very expensive?
Yeah, because it's quite challenging to produce these powder in the right particle size distribution with the right surface. We've seen these SAM images. You've seen that there's a slightly rough surface on these powder particles, and this is why to increase the flowability of the powder particles, a slightly rough surface is favorable, for example.
Okay, and since you've worked for such a long time in that field, have you seen the prices of the powders come down since you started? And you definitely don't need to give prices. I know that's all depends very much on your negotiation skills, but did you see any changes?
Yeah, I think for standard powder, which exists during the last 10 years, there's maybe a slight decrease in the prices. But at the moment, a huge research field, but also in industry, they've seen that the need for different powders is higher. That's why if you develop a new powder, the starting prices are always a little bit higher compared if you have a powder 2, 3, or 4 years on the market.
Okay, yeah, I see. Then I have a question. I have a question about the market, and that's about another comparison between polymer and metal powder bed fusion. Is one bigger than the other? Do you see growth in one? Can you say something about that?
Yes, the market and the relevance of plastic powder bed fusion and plastic additive manufacturing techniques is quite high. As you can see on this slide, that today's AM market segment differentiated by material, you see that a huge amount of sold material is in the field of photopolymers, afterwards powders for powder bed fusion techniques, and then filaments. And the amount of sold metal powders and filament is quite low compared to the plastic market, but this is due to these large market segment in the field of photopolymers due to specific application as hearing aids, for example. The market growth is a little bit changing at the moment, so my guess would be that the market growth of metal additive manufacturing is higher compared to plastic additive manufacturing. This is due to different application fields, for example, especially in the field of aviation and aerospace. I think additive manufacturing has a huge, strong additive manufacturing of metals, has huge strength in this field or for power applications.
And that's a very interesting slide and overview because only the metal and polymer powder bed fusion processes have really seen this strong use in end-use parts, and they have similar properties compared to conventional processing technologies. But I found it very insightful what you said, for example, about the aligners for tooth correction. That's a huge market for photopolymers, and it seems to show. And what I'm also very surprised by is that filaments is relatively low. But I guess home users don't play such a significant role in additive manufacturing as they might have 10 years ago. So you said that the metals market seems to grow more. Is that also something, if you know, that's visible in machine sales or overall? What's the average price of a machine, if you can say that? I know that's also you might get different prices, but maybe you can say something about market prices.
Yeah, that depends on the size of your system, on the level of automation, on the seller itself. So, for example, in Germany, there are many companies in the field of powder bed fusion of metal systems. They sell metal systems, and only a few manufacturers for powder bed fusion of plastic. But it really depends. There's a huge range of money you could spend to buy a new additive manufacturing system.
Okay, so it's but what you said is one of the indicators, or one of the things that have an impact on the price, is the size of the machine and the build envelope and the add-ons. Is handling also a big part of that market? Do you need the machine and then you need a lot of handling equipment to put the powder in and take it out and clean the parts? What's probably the relation of work and money intensity?
Yeah, unfortunately, a lot of people forget that it's not only buying a machine, it's also powder handling after your building process is finished. You have to remove, in the field of metals, for example, the parts from your building platform. This is also, at the moment, in many cases, manual work. But there are emerging market on automation solutions for powder handling, for removal from the powder platform, for removal of the whole powder from the building space, and so on. So this is a huge area and a challenge, but this is also something we are working on at the university.
Okay, and when you say about you mentioned the powder handling already in answer to one of my previous questions, and now could you say a little bit more about the refreshing and how much of the powder in a build actually goes into part production, and how much you have left over that needs to be reused?
Mm-hmm. Okay, maybe let's first start with the area of powder bed fusion of plastics. So if you have an average building job, only around 20% of the powder is used for really part production. So you have these surrounding powder, which acts as support structure itself. And 80% of this powder, or this whole powder, can be reused for another building process, but it has to be mixed with new powder, which is called virgin powder. It depends on the powder itself. In the field of polyamide, for example, typical ratio between used and virgin powder is around 50%, but it could be reused for a new building process. If we have a look on metal powders, it's almost the same. You have these support structures. These support structures has to be removed from the part and from the building platform. This could not be used at all. This is unfortunately up to now waste material, but a surrounding powder can be reused without any refreshing to an extent of 100%.
Okay. And so one of the last big questions, and maybe there might be some smaller follow-ups, is about the characterization methods. You talked about powder, you talked about the process, and now we also talked about the parts. What are the typical characterization methods that you're using in research that help you to develop the process to understand your material behavior?
Yeah, maybe in, of course, in research, we are using high sophisticated methods, but maybe I will give you a glance on the industrial side. In industry, you typically, first of all, have to have an idea on the powder quality itself. And therefore, you analyze bulk properties, for example, with analyzing the flowability or the bulk density. That's typical from these bulk material sites. Then you analyze the viscosity of your material. The most easy thing to analyze the viscosity is within a melt flow index, for example. Then you analyze the thermal behavior. You've seen in DSC, schematic DSC diagram before, where you analyze, okay, where's the melting point, where's the crystallization point or area, and where should be these processing window, which is also, I think these are the typical analyzing methods in the field of AM, yeah.
And so is that typical that the part producer and the actual processing company is doing those tests, or is that something that's on the data sheet and you just work with the powder as received without any tests?
It depends on the application of your part. If you only print parts for prototype production or for some, maybe not for consumer goods, but for something which has not really high regulations due to final part quality, then it's on the data sheet and, okay, it's in the right range of the data sheet or of the certificate, and then it's okay. But in many cases, also in industry, they make something like quality assurance of your powder and analyze each batch of your powder in dependency of particle size distribution, of rheological characteristics, or also thermal characteristics.
Okay, so probably also depends how big a company is. And are there more small companies that only have one or two machines, or is the majority of service providers and processors in that range where they have 10 to 20 machines?
Yeah, this also depends. So service providers, there are a lot of service providers on the market which only deal with printing 3D printed parts and sell it to some people. But there is a bunch of industries and divisions where a specific goal is reached and they have one system, for example, to produce some ads for the workers in the production field or something like this. So it really depends. I think starting from one machine going to, 30 or 40, you can find everything in industry.
Okay. 30 and 40 is already a high number. And then I'd like to get back to the characterization for one more question. All the methods that you mentioned, I'm somehow familiar with from conventional polymer processing. Are they also used with the same standards, ISO and ASTM standards? And is there also development in the area of standardization that's happening in those processes?
Yeah, there's a huge development in standardization, also for the characterization methods, which characterization methods can be used for additive manufacturing. But if you have a deeper look inside these characterization methods, a huge bunch of these methods are developed for example, injection molding processes. If you have a look, for example, on the thermal behavior, in laser material processing, you have heating rates which are magnitudes higher compared to injection molding, for example. Therefore, these methods are mainly used to get an idea whether the material is in the right range, but a lot of these methods are not able to say something about the later process behavior. This is a huge challenge also in research and in industry. And this is also this is something we are focusing at the university. Which method can be used to get an idea on the final process behavior?
Okay. Yeah, I'm very astonished how much input and wealth of information you could pack in all of your answers. So I'm very happy we decided to record this so the audience can go back and maybe listen once or twice at some of the things you said, because you added so many insights from a practical perspective, because you work on a day-to-day basis with it. So thank you very much. I also like to thank the audience. You can leave more questions in the chat or later on. I encourage you, if you're a researcher, a student, or even an industry, and this is your field, follow Professor Wudy's research. There are a lot of interesting papers published by her, and I'm sure there will be a lot more in the future. So thank you very much, Katrin, for your time and sharing your insights with us.
Yeah, thank you very much for the interview. And if there are any questions from the audience, just write me an email or, yeah.
Thank you for that offer as well. Thank you very much, and bye-bye.
Bye-bye.